First, a couple disclaimers need to be made. First and foremost, we are not recommending nor condoning any of these activities. Second, for large institutions and traditional financial systems, some of these mixing practices may even be illegal. This is simply an intellectual exercise to understand how it may be possible for you to anonymize your funds to make it more difficult for someone else to track your activity. To better understand mixing's mechanisms, we're going to examine a traditional scenario where money's origins are obfuscated, money laundering. The reason why money laundering serves as a good base is because their goals are the same. As discussed before when talking about regulations, money laundering is the very illegal activity of moving large amounts of undetected money between countries or between the underground and legitimate economy. Traditional money laundering uses hundreds of fake shell companies, called shells because they don't do anything or own any assets. However, they appear to in order to successfully serve as money laundering devices for tax purposes. The first step to money laundering is placement. Over time, the dirty funds, or funds obtained through illicit means, are placed into the shell companies. The shell corporations write off the deposits as purchases, investments, services provided, etc., in order to make the appearance of legitimate money entering the business through legitimate means. The next step is layering. This is the step where shell companies further pass their money through other shell companies in order to further complicate the financial supply chain to hide the true origin of the money. This step of the process is what mixing will simulate. The final step of the process is integration. This refers to when the clean money is reintroduced into the legitimate economy through the purchase of luxury goods, the end goal of all this money laundering. Mixing will attempt to simulate this process of money obfuscation by sending coins through several complicated processes. To better understand what it means to be anonymous in our context, let's formally define something known as an anonymity set. This will be defined as the set of pseudonyms between which an entity cannot be distinguished from their counterparts. In other words, it is impossible to do anything better than guess when trying to choose an address within an anonymity set to associate with some given entity. The goal of mixing, then, is to maximize this anonymity set with our resources. Let's say that mixing, when done correctly, now makes your entity indistinguishable within a set of n peers. This means that the anonymity set's size after one round is n. Done again with another unique n peers for each address, the anonymity size is now n squared after the second round. It becomes n cubed after three rounds, and so on. However, we do have to keep real-world constraints in mind, such as however many resources are available, along with the implications of mixing. Matters such as plausible deniability and trustlessness of mixing also come into play, since mixing alone isn't enough to absolve someone of suspicion. First off, trustlessness is desirable. Clearly, given the nature of the blockchain space, we want to ensure that there's no counterparty risk. If someone else participates in the coin mixing process, they shouldn't be able to deny our services. Additionally, we want to avoid our funds from being stolen. Second, we want to maintain plausible deniability. It shouldn't stand out from one's transaction history or any other data sources that you're mixing. If that's the case, then your activities will fall under much more scrutiny, even if you've done nothing wrong. These are properties we'll seek after building up some basic examples of mixing. To make clear, there's a fundamental idea behind mixing. The larger the anonymity set, the harder it is to link pseudonyms to real identities. There are several types of mixers. These include centralized mixers, altcoin exchanges, decentralized mixing protocols, and privacy-focused altcoins. We'll take a look at mixers in that order. The most simple kind of mixer, the easiest to design, is a centralized one, particularly a protocol known as third-party protocol, or TPP. By understanding a centralized solution first, we can then explore how other protocols may build off of this main design. With TPP, a centralized mixing service will have a set of UTXOs, referred to here as a slush fund. Whenever someone sends an input to this mixer, the mixing service operator will choose a set of UTXOs to return back to a new address also controlled by Alice. At the end, Alice now has her clean funds minus the fee the mixing service kept. It's not hard to see some of the issues with the centralized service. One of these issues comes down to counterparty risk. In this case, you have to trust the central service providing coin mixing services for you. There's hardly anything stopping them beyond reputation from withholding tokens from you. Additionally, you have to trust that the mixer is not keeping logs on your information. It's possible that the central party, in order to blackmail certain users or for some other purpose, is keeping a list of users who provided dirty inputs as well as the eventual clean funds they claimed. Finally, a centralization risk exists as well. Because of a single point of failure, which can be brought down by hacking or by a government institution demanding the shutdown of the service, it's not guaranteed the miner will operate as expected. Additionally, a small note to make. If the only UTXOs being sent to the centralized mixer are dirty coins, those dirty coins will end up becoming the new outputs for later users. Without enough clean coins being cycled into the slush fund, it could cause the mixing to do little for cleaning your coins. A couple examples of centralized mixing services include MixCoin, which came out of Princeton Research, and BlindCoin, which came out of UMD and UPenn. This is an example of how theory meets practical applications. The next category of mixing to examine is altcoin exchange mixing. Rather than relying on a specific central service to perform the exclusive act of centrally mixing your coins, one can use a series of exchanges to bring money from Bitcoin to several other cryptocurrencies, such as Ether and Zcash, before finally coming back to Bitcoin. In this case, the cost of mixing coins is not a central mixing fee, but rather the exchange fees between each cryptocurrency used. The benefits of this approach is that the attacker now has to trace the transaction chain through several disparate blockchains and exchanges rather than simply examining a single blockchain. Additionally, this process provides better plausible deniability, since the activity looks like normal currency exchanging. However, you need to rely on exchanges not to reveal the links between your inputs and the outputs you receive on the other end. Additionally, there still remains counterparty risk. If the exchange happens to get hacked or otherwise freezes services during your mixing process, you'll lose whatever money you had in transit. Finally, most exchanges in the US are required to keep personally identifiable information and follow KYC/AML laws, as mentioned before, meaning that such activity may appear suspicious to exchanges, especially if done repeatedly.